Hello, welcome back to SSL TLS episode 20. After a very long time, I am making this episode. This is Saravanan learning along with you. I have earlier mentioned that in the past episode that in TLS, so how does a typical TLS work? I already told that in TLS you have a client, you have a server. At the very beginning, you will have what is called a TLS handshake, right? The first part of the handshake is agreeing for the cipher parameters, whatever parameters. That is the cipher parameters agreement, okay? Cipher agreement. Cipher suite agreement. Cipher suite agreement happens as the first part of the key exchange. Then the second part of the key exchange is server authentication. Server authentication will happen. Thereafter, the third part of the key exchange is the actual key will get exchanged, okay? Or it will get exchanged or it will get derived on the both side. So today we are going to talk about the second key exchange method. The popularly used key exchange method in TLS are RSA, DHC and ECDHC. RSA we have already covered in one of the past episodes. So today we are going to learn about the Diffie-Hellman ephemeral. But before we talk about the ephemeral, I will first tell what is Diffie-Hellman key exchange is about. It was invented, as the name suggests, by Whitfield Diffie. He is one of the very popular cryptographer. I took this picture from Wikipedia, so the credit goes to Wikipedia. And it was also invented jointly together with Martin Hellman, who is also a very great cryptographer. Okay, actually they are the first two cryptographers, Diffie and Hellman, in the year 1976. They published a groundbreaking paper called New Directions in Cryptography. This is a groundbreaking paper in the history of cryptography, because only in this paper, for the very first time, they invented the public key cryptography and openly told it to the world. Okay. In the past episode, I also told the alternate history of the invention of public key cryptography. You can go and check the past episode. So this in only in this paper they explained about the so-called Diffie-Hellman key exchange. Okay, so let's quickly see what is this Diffie-Hellman key exchange is about. The Diffie-Hellman key exchange can be divided into two types. The first one is called static key exchange. The second one is called ephemeral key exchange. Static means it always use the same key. Okay, ephemeral means for every single connection, it will choose a completely different key. That is a ephemeral. The word ephemeral means temporary. That is, it will use a temporary key for every single connection. In reality, this is the most popular one, because the static key exchange does not provide a property called perfect forward secrecy. We already covered this property when we talk about the RSA, right? RSA key exchange does not provide the so-called perfect forward secrecy, whereas that ephemeral key exchange, Diffie-Hellman ephemeral key exchange, provide the so-called perfect forward secrecy. The meaning of this we already learned in one of the past episodes. And unlike RSA, in RSA, it is a key transport mechanism. If you remember how RSA works, typically you have a client and server, right? The client generates a 46-byte random number. It will prepend this 46-byte along with a TLS version number. And together, this is a 2-byte, 2 plus 48, together 48-byte random number, okay? The first two is not random, it always represents the TLS version number. So the remaining 46 is random. So together this 48 byte is encrypted using the server public key and sent to the server in the client key exchange message. The server wants the private key. So using the private key, it will decrypt and retrieve the 48 byte. So this 48 byte in RSA, it is called pre-master secret. So when it comes to RSA, literally that key is being transported in the wire or wireless, okay? The key is sitting inside this client key exchange message in the encrypted format. That's why we call key transport mechanism when we talk about RSA key exchange. Whereas in Diffie-Hellman key exchange, we don't transport anything, okay? We don't transport anything. Instead, both the parties derive the key on their own side using certain formula, okay? Both the parties separately derive the key on their own side using a common formula. So next we will talk about how this mechanism works. So what we are going to see is the Diffie-Hellman key exchange. The Diffie-Hellman key exchange is a key agreement protocol that allows two parties to establish a shared secret over an insecure communication channel. The channel itself is insecure. Anybody can, any hacker can look at the channel and they can see what is going on the channel, okay? That's why we call it an insecure channel. So Alice is sitting on this one end, Bob is sitting on the other end, and this hacker can take a look at what they are communicating. So that means I have to encrypt my content, as well as I should make sure I am really talking to the genuine Bob or genuine Alice, okay? So that is a requirement. In reality, when you use it over TLS, the client we don't authenticate, only the server we will authenticate, and we will verify we are really talking to the genuine server or not. So in reality, Diffie-Hellman key exchange, even though it's happened over an insecure channel, we always authenticate the server to make sure I am talking to the genuine guy. So next one. So the trick of the Diffie-Hellman key exchange is, Diffie-Hellman key exchange depends on what is called a one-way function. One-way function, okay? The purpose of the one-way function is, to perform certain operation on one way, the operation is performed very easily, okay? And given this answer, if I ask what is the input, it is impossible to perform this, okay? One way it is easy, the other way it is impossible to do this. We have already learned about this one-way function when we talked about the RSA in one of the past episodes. Diffie-Hellman key exchange uses what is called a discrete logarithm problem. Discrete logarithm problem. We will talk about the mathematics behind this in another episode. So today I won't go into the very elaborate details of this. So in Diffie-Hellman key exchange, usually I have Alice and Bob. At the very beginning, Alice is acting as a client and Bob is acting as a server, okay? At the very beginning, the Bob fellow, he decides two parameters called G and P. These two parameters are called domain parameters. Okay, these two parameters are called domain parameters. He will decide these two parameters and he will transport this parameter in a special message called server key exchange. Okay, server key exchange. And he also generates his own public private key and he generates the public key uppercase B equal to G power B mod P, using a formula G power B mod P. This P is actually a very long prime number, okay? This P is a very long prime number. Typically, the size of this prime number can be 1024 bit or 2048 bit or higher, okay? So, this is the most safest number of bits used today, even though some software still support 1024 bit. Whereas G is here, typically for G, in most cases we use an integer called 2, the value called 2, G equal to 2, okay? You can use other number as well, but typically they use the integer 2 for certain mathematical reason. So G and P are called domain parameters. So this fellow will calculate the B, which is a public key. So when he send in the server key exchange message, he will send G, P, as well as his public key B. So on this side, the Alice will receive G, P as well as B, and she generate her own private key and she calculate the public key A equal to G power A mod P, okay? Then she will send her public key using the message called client key exchange. Inside this message, she will send her public key A. So at this point in time, both the sides will have G, P, B, she has received, she also know her own private key as well as her own public key. This fellow will know G, P, his own private key, his own public key. What else? As well as what he received from the other side, okay? Now, Alice will derive the key K is nothing but what she got from the other side. She got from the other side B, right? She will do B power A. A is her own private key, B power A mod P, which is nothing but, we know B is nothing but G power B, right? G power B power A mod P, which is equal to G power B A mod P, which is again equal to G power A B, because it's a commutative, it has a mathematical commutative property, meaning A star B equal to B star A. So it can be written as G power A B mod P. On the other side, he will, On the other side, Bob will derive the key in a similar way. He has got public key A from the other side, right? So he will use his private key A power B mod P. We know A is nothing but G power B, so power A mod P, which is equal to G power B A mod P, which is equal to, due to the commutative property, B star A equal to A star B, so G power A B mod P. So the important lesson here is, both the sides end up with the exact same key. Both the sides end up with the exact same key, okay? It's the exact same key. So that's why we call this fellow as a key agreement protocol. Both sides will agree with the common key using certain mathematical formula. So this is how the Diffie-Hellman key exchange is working, by ending up with the same key on the both sides. So in summary, client is there, server is there. At the beginning, server generate G, At the beginning, server generate G, P. He also has his own private key and he generates his public key and send these three in a message called server key exchange. In return, client will have her own private key and she generates her public key and send the public key in a message called client key exchange. So these two messages are very important in TLS. Okay. So later I will show how this look like in a packet capture. But one important point is, because we always authenticate the server, so when the server sends these three parameters, it will also sign this parameter and send the signature of this parameter. Okay. Signature of the parameter in the inside the server key exchange message. Because server already has a certificate, certificate has a public key and server also has access to his private key. So he uses his private key to perform the signature and client already has a certificate. Client use the public key of the server and he will verify the signature. Okay. Whereas client key exchange, there is no signature inside client key exchange because the client does not have the certificate. Typically when you use TLS on internet, client always authenticate the server. Only in very rare cases server will authenticate the client. Okay. In a typical cases, client don't have the certificate. So that means you don't have access to your private key of the whatever RSA private key or whatever the certificate private key. Because of that, you cannot sign it. Okay. So client key exchange is not signed, whereas server key exchange, all the parameters are signed. Okay. So one side we are providing security, other side there is no security. I mean client key exchange side. If you want to, all these things looks very complicated, don't worry. In a real life, Diffie-Hellman typically is explained using an example. For example, you have two colors, okay? Let me take the red color and the green color. If you mix these two colors, you mix the two colors and produce a new color, okay? Now, for a random person, there is a random person here. If I give this color to him, and if I ask him, tell me what two color I mix to produce this color, it's very difficult to tell. So one way this operation is easier, the other way the operation is not possible. It's very, very difficult because there are so many combinations which may be able to produce this thing, right? Just by looking at the color, he won't be able to tell 100% what combination of two color he has mixed to produce this color. So this is how Diffie-Hellman key exchange also working, okay? This is another example of a one-way function. Now let's talk about the DH parameter security. So what are the parameters we generated? At the beginning, Alice and Bob is there. Bob generated a domain parameter called GP, which is a very long prime number, right? I told these two are domain parameters. The security of the Diffie-Hellman key exchange depends on the quality of these domain parameters. The server could send weak or insecure parameter and compromise the security of the session. This issue was highlighted in a few years back. There was an attack called triple handshake attack. Okay, triple handshake attack. So this issue was highlighted in the triple handshake attack, where which covered weak DH parameter used as one of the attack vector. So because of that, we must use a really strong and powerful domain parameter G and P. You cannot just like that use anyhow, you cannot use, okay? You have to check with the cryptographer whether the parameter I am using is strong or not. The second thing is, the DH parameter negotiation. I told you the P is a prime number. Typically, the P prime number in the past, the prime number used to was something like 512 bit, and later they move on to 768 bit, and later they move on to 1024 bit, and nowadays we are using 2048 bits, okay? So it depends on the strength of this parameter. Unfortunately, with the TLS, there is no way the client can negotiate the parameter with the server, okay? Let's say the server has decided to use the 2K bit, okay? And there is no way client can tell he only support 1K bit. There is no way the client can tell, okay? There is no provision available in TLS for client and server to negotiate what is the strength of the parameter. So that is another problem with Diffie-Hellman key exchange. So the third problem is insufficient parameter strength. For example, many of the server even today they use 1024 bit Diffie-Hellman. When we say 1024 bit, we are talking about the size of the prime number P is equal to 1024 bit. Of course, if you use this, eventually the key size that you get is also 1024 bit, okay? Most servers nowadays still is using 1024 bit, but 1024 bit is considered no longer secure, okay? The reason is, historically speaking, the Diffie-Hellman parameters have been largely ignored and the security was neglected. Many libraries and servers use weak Diffie-Hellman parameters by default and often don't provide a means to configure Diffie-Hellman parameter strength. For this reason, it is not uncommon to see servers using 1024-bit parameters and insecure 768, even some use 512-bit parameters. More recently, some platforms have started using very strong, like 2048 bits and higher parameters. A few years back, I think in May 2005, there was an attack making use of this vulnerability called logjam attack, which showed that 512-bit Diffie-Hellman parameters can be successfully exploited in real time by an attacker with modest resources, and speculated that a strong attacker might even be able to exploit 768-bit parameters. The same research also highlighted the possibility that a very strong attacker could also break the small number of very widely used 1024-bit standard group to passively exploit millions of internet servers. Okay, we don't go into the fine details of the logjam attack. If you are interested, you can Google for the logjam attack. So in short, 512-bit is no longer secure, 768-bit is no longer secure. Even though 1024-bit is not practically broken, people believe that some powerful agencies have capability to break this. So in practice, you should not use this, but unfortunately, many servers on internet is still using this. So the most safest size for Diffie-Hellman parameter nowadays is using minimum 2048-bit, okay? This is the safest recommended size. Now let us see how the server key exchange message and the client key exchange message looks in a real TLS. So in a TLS packet, here I am showing you TLS 1.2 server key exchange message. If you look at the details of the server key exchange message, come all the way, drill down, you will see Diffie-Hellman server parameters. You will see the prime number P length is 256 bytes. So 256 bytes means 256 times 8, which is 2048 bit strength, okay? 2048 bit strength. And G value is typically used is the integer 2, okay? Integer 2, because for some cryptographical properties, they always prefer this integer 2, even though other values are also possible. So this is the public key, the B that we calculated, right? Bob private key is lowercase b, and Bob public key is uppercase b. That is the B, which is the public key. And next, if you look at the client key exchange message, Alice is sending higher public key, okay? Remember, Alice public key is calculated using G power A mod P, where A is lowercase a is the Alice private key. And G and P, how does Alice know? Because in the previous message, Bob sent the value of G and P to Alice. That's how she know. Thereafter, she calculated the A and sent it A in her client key exchange message. Next, we are going to do some practical exercises using that. I am going to use, as usual, I am going to use the OpenSSL command line for this, okay? So you can use the OpenSSL command and generate the DH parameter. The command is OpenSSL DH param. Output you can save in the file dhparam.pem, Diffie-Hellman parameter.pem. You can tell the key size, okay? For example, I will use the key size 1024 bit. It will take some time, it will generate the key. Now if you do a cat dhparam, you notice that it has created a key called begin dh parameter, end dh parameters, okay? So this is what we see. Next I am going to show what it contains in human readable text format. OpenSSL dhparam-in dhparam.pem-text-noout less command. So inside you will see it has generated a prime number. It's a very long prime number. The size is 1024 bit, and the generator value is just the integer 2. Okay, so that is the content of the DH parameter. There is also a command on OpenSSL to check whether the DH parameter you are using is a mathematically correct or not. You can do this check minus in dhparam dot this text no out. It will do the testing, okay? No out. It will do the testing and say DH parameter appears to be okay. Earlier I told you that there are some issues with the Diffie-Hellman key exchange, ephemeral key exchange. That is, the parameter that we are using has to be very, very strong, right? So how do we know whether the parameters are strong or not? The common man doesn't know. We need a help of a cryptographer to certify that the parameter we are using is strong. So instead of using some random parameters, the cryptographers has already pre-calculated certain parameter which they consider is very, very safe for use, okay? Those parameters are called named groups. It's called named group, and there is a new standard now in the name of the RFC 7919. It's called negotiated finite field Diffie-Hellman ephemeral parameters. We usually call it as FFDHE, finite field Diffie-Hellman ephemeral parameter. And to support this, there is a new standard called 7919. Basically what in this standard they did was, they already pre-calculated the value of G and P, which they thoroughly mathematically checked that they are very, very safe to use, okay? So they are called named groups, and in order to support this negotiation of the parameter length, where the client and server can negotiate what is the size of the parameter they are supporting. Previously I told you this is not possible, right? Now it is possible thanks to the 7919 RFC. So let me show you this RFC. So this is the RFC, okay? Negotiated finite field Diffie-Hellman ephemeral parameters for transport layer security. So if you come down all the way, there is something called named groups, okay? It's called named group overview. You can check here, a named group. So they have created a standard finite field DHE 2048 bit parameters. The values are fixed always, okay? It won't change. Similarly, finite field Diffie-Hellman ephemeral for 3K bits and 4K bit key, 6K bit key, 8K bit P. So these are all called named parameters. And in order to support this, they created a brand new TLS extension called supported underscore groups. Okay, supported underscore group. The same extension you can also use to tell the information about your elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman parameters. So later when we talk about elliptic curve DHE, I will talk about that. Okay. So when the client sends the client hello message, in the client hello message, the client will tell what are the finite field Diffie-Hellman groups it supports, whether it supports 2K key or 3K key, 4K key, 8K key, etc. Similarly, the server will choose one among the what client support, and then in the server hello, server will reply with the supported group TLS extension, and in that it will choose the size of the Diffie-Hellman ephemeral parameter. So this is a new standard. So many clients as of now still don't support this, okay? This is a pretty new standard. I think for this week I will stop here. Thank you very much for joining today's session. Hope you to see in the next episode soon. Thank you.